to Critical Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Mason Dambrot. Critical Thought TV looks at connections between different areas of human cognitive and creative expression, and then takes that those observations and looks into the future as to where we might be going as technology and science accelerate. We're honored to have Jason Silva today as our first guest.
Oh, thank you.
So I've seen your documentaries, I've read your work, I've heard you in presentations. Why don't you give us your view of the singularity, which is today's topic, and your role in it?
Yeah, well, you know, I spent the last couple of years hosting a TV show for Al Gore's cable network, Current TV, and I've always had this intense passion for the intersection of science and art. So even though on Current, my role was as a presenter of all things interesting, I like to say, sort of curating citizen journalism and user-generated content from all over the world.
Given the context of the singularity that we're discussing today, what's your view of humanity's current condition pre-singularity?
Well, it's interesting because the singularity has been named the rapture of the geeks to the extent that secular-minded scientific thinkers have embraced the idea, and it has captured their imagination to the extent that it might deliver what religion once promised but never did, namely the idea of radically extended lifespans, infinity in all directions, the ability to be omniscient, omnipotent, you know, the kingdom of God, right, the place of heaven. Sounds to me a lot like what the singularity promises, which is this place sort of beyond the event horizon, this metaphor we borrow from physics, the singularity, to describe this point in the future that is unfathomably richer in every possible way. Infinite art, infinitely more intelligent beings, substrate-independent minds, decentralized consciousness so that we don't have to worry about mortality or biological aging or entropy. I mean, ultimately, the pre-singularity human condition has always been defined by the fleeting nature of existence. You know, Ernest Becker wrote his book, The Denial of Death, which talks about the fact that man is the only animal that is cognizant of the fact that he is mortal, to the extent that we are gods with anuses. With our minds, we can ponder the infinite, yet we're housed in a heart-pumping, breath-gasping, decaying body. So we are godly, yet creaturely. And so we have created stories to make ourselves feel better, which makes sense because man can live for, you know, a couple weeks without food, a couple days without water, but not for an hour without hope in the face of his mortality. So religion gave us one option. Increasingly, it's less relevant due to science and technology. The romantic solution is Becker's other solution to the death anxiety. We turn our lovers into deities, and in their arms we find salvation. And then the creative solution, which is technology and creativity, has been the way that we symbolically eternalize ourselves by making meaningful contributions in the world. Ultimately, all are doomed to fail because we still die, and that is a tragedy that creatures that can love and write poetry are ultimately food for worms. And I think what's interesting about indefinite lifespans, reprogramming our DNA, you know, having invented the gods, we can turn into them, as Alan Harrington says. The singularity promises an intellectual, techno-scientific transcendence of our animal condition. Which is the goal of humanity, according to Ray Kurzweil. So that's one way of looking at it, but let's continue.
Yeah, let's. It occurred to me while you were talking that the ultimate snafu is being creatures that are able to imagine immortality.
Yes.
And always have it outside of the grasp, like our grasp, as if we're always running towards something in an infinite distance.
Yes.
But now, from what you're saying, and I agree, that we're on the verge of potentially, perhaps even as soon as the next 25 to 30 years, being able to make great strides towards realizing that intent.
Well, you know, I hope so. I mean, there's that, I think it was Jean-Paul Sartre who says, because we can imagine, we are free. I remember the director of the Imaginary Foundation, when talking about his desire to launch this think tank to explore the possibilities of the imagination in all directions, he was inspired by this Jean-Paul Sartre line. And it's true. Because we can imagine, we are free. Increasingly, I've said this before, but as technology has evolved and advanced in an exponential fashion, what technology does is it sort of increasingly shrinks the lag time between what we can imagine and what we can create in the real world. It was Terence McKenna, the psychedelic visionary, who once actually said that the moment that we invented language, basically biological evolution was trumped in favor of cultural epigenetic evolution, which is to say that the human mind takes in matter of low organization. We put it through our mental filters and we extrude it in the form of space shuttles and poetry and nanotechnology and the internet. You know, Freeman Dyson, the physicist, says in the near future, a new generation of artists will be writing genomes with the fluency that Blake and Byron wrote verses. So to the extent that once we could think in rich symbolic ways, once we could have language, you know, Kevin Kelly says we could invent with purpose and deliberation, we could conjure up alternative, delightful possibilities for ourselves, pick the most ecstatic one, and then pull the present forward to meet that possibility that we conjured up in our heads. In fact, Ray Kurzweil's last line from The Singularity Is Near says, "It turns out that we are central, after all, in the cosmos. Our ability to create virtual models, virtual realities in our heads, combined with our modest-looking thumbs, was sufficient to usher in another form of evolution called technology, and it will continue until the entire universe is at our fingertips." So not to get like all excited and preachy, but I can't help it sometimes because I sort of mediate my insights through my euphoria when thinking about these things, so I can't help myself.
How can you not?
Exactly.
Really, how can you not?
Exactly. Is that the ultimate antidote to existential despair? Is it not nice to know that really we can do anything? Anything is possible. You know, the cosmos is infinite. Carl Sagan said, "We are the way for the cosmos to know itself." The cosmos is uttering articulated thought through our nervous system. So if the cosmos is infinite, why can't we be as well? You know, I think if we are the frontal lobe of the universe, you know, as Howard Bloom wrote, I just think galaxies of possibility remain open to us. And for us not to seize that, for us not to, you know, As Stuart Brand said, we are as gods and might as well get good at it. Why not embrace our role as cosmic heroes rather than succumb to the existential malaise of acknowledging entropy and mortality and limitation in any form?
Yeah, you mentioning entropy is relevant. Biological life seems to be negentropic. We're intentionally negentropic, yes. which is really fascinating, I think.
You're a genius. I love that. Keep going, please.
But on top of that, if technological evolution is the continued biologically driven need for us to extend our sensory and motor cortices into the environment, then it brings me to a really important question, which is, how do you see the role of synthetic biology in us catching up to our inventions?
Oh, yeah. I mean, first off, this idea that life is anti-entropic has been articulated by some visionary thinkers, even Buckminster Fuller, okay, the performing philosopher. He said life is anti-entropic. It's this idea that even though on the scale of the whole universe, right, the second law of thermodynamics of entropy, right, it holds true that everything is slowly simplifying and going from real complex entities or molecules or structures into simpler matter of less organization. But life is anti-entropic. Life gets more complex. Atoms come together into larger structures, which coalesce into larger structures. You know, Kevin Kelly calls it up-creation. Up creation, right? And creating complexity as the scale moves upwards. Stephen Johnson has talked about this, you know, how slime mold is like neurons in a brain is like a city. I mean, it's this idea that as complexity emerges, right, across different scales of reality. So, yes, large picture is that entropy is breaking everything down into simpler constituents, but within the Goldilocks place where life exists, it's getting more complex. And the skirmishes of that evolution of complexity has been the life and death of individuals. You know, their DNA mixes, hopefully it tries something new out that helps the species, but then it has to kill off those original hosts, those parents. What's not to say that intelligence might not be the universe's secret weapon, life's secret weapon, to eventually overshadow and trump entropy in a sort of transcalar cosmic victory where intelligence eventually becomes much more powerful than entropy?
The intelligent application of energy to a system is the only proven way of combating entropy anyway.
Wow. Say that again, please.
The application of energy. If you have, small colored balls, they'll randomize if you shake. Yeah. But if you continually apply energy and focus where you want them to go, you can create order. But it takes a continual application as energy, as entropy throws energy out of the system.
Isn't that genius? The continual application of intelligence into matter is what, say that again, is into matter is what eventually...
Eventually...
Transcends entropy, overcomes entropy.
Or at least battles it.
Couldn't say it better myself.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you so much. This was great.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.